Nama Om Vishnu Padaya Krishna Prasaya Bhutale Srimate Bhakti
with some prayer. We did some nice prayers before Darshanarti. So with the success of that, we're trying another variation. So this is the Garbha Stuti. These are prayers that from Srimad Bhagavatam that the demigods made when they understood that Krishna had appeared in Devaki's womb. So in preparation to see the Lord on his appearance day, and as you are all demigods, as you're all wonderful effulgent demigods, so and maybe you were there reciting these prayers before. So we will recite these prayers as our meditation. So the way we're going to do it is Sarabhi Kunj Mataji will lead us in the Sanskrit, and we'll do it like almost like a Bhagavatam class. This is very simple. She will just recite one line in the verse, and everyone please respond enthusiastically. And then after we do the Sanskrit, I will read the translation, and then we go to our next verse. Okay, so she lead one line, everyone please respond with full heart, praying to the Lord, and we hear the translations. Okay?
Thank you very much. yoninitam ca satye.
Satyasya yoninitam ca satye.
Satyasya satyamrita satyanetra.
Satyasya satyamrita satyanetra.
Satyatmakam dva sharanam prapanna.
Satyatmakam dva sharanam prapanna.
The demigods prayed, O Lord, you never deviate from your vow, which is always perfect, because whatever you decide is perfectly correct and cannot be stopped by anyone. Being present in the three phases of cosmic manifestation, creation, maintenance, and annihilation, you are the supreme truth. Indeed, unless one is completely truthful, one cannot achieve your favor, which therefore cannot be achieved by hypocrites. You are the active principle, the real truth in all the ingredients of creation, and therefore you are known as Antaryami, the inner force. You are equal to everyone, and your instructions apply for everyone, for all time. You are the beginning of all truth, therefore, offering our obeisances, we surrender unto you. Kindly,
give us protection.
Dvayambhujakshakila satyadhamni.
Dvayambhujakshakila satyadhamni.
Samadhinavishita cetasaike.
Samadhinavishita cetasaike.
Lord, by concentrating one's meditation on your lotus feet, which are the reservoir of all existence, and by accepting those lotus feet as the boat by which to cross the ocean of nescience, one follows in the footsteps of the Mahajans, great saints, sages, and devotees. By this simple process, one can cross the ocean of nescience as easily as one steps over the hoofprint of a cat.
Yen ye ravindaksha vimukta maninas.
Yen ye ravindaksha vimukta maninas.
Vayasta bhavata visuddha buddhaya.
Vayasta bhavata visuddha buddhaya.
Aruhya kritrena parampadam tatha.
Aruhya kritrena parampadam.
Someone may say that aside from devotees who always seek shelter at the Lord's lotus feet, they are those who are not devotees but who have accepted different processes for attaining salvation. What happens to them? In answer to this question, Lord Brahma and the other demigods said, O lotus-eyed Lord, although non-devotees who accept severe austerities and penances to achieve the highest position may think themselves liberated, their intelligence is impure. They fall down from their position of imagined superiority because they have no regard for your lotus feet.
Tathana te madhava dava kakvachi.
Tathana te madhava dava kakvachi.
Brashanti marga tvai bada saurida.
Brashanti marga tvai bada saurida.
Tvaya vidutta vicharanti nirvaya.
Tvaya vidutta vicharanti.
Vinayaka
Nikapa Murdaso Prabhu
O Madhava, Supreme Personality of Godhead, Lord of the Goddess of Fortune, if devotees completely in love with you sometimes fall from the path of devotion, they do not fall like non-devotees, for you still protect them. Thus they fearlessly traverse the heads of their opponents and continue to progress in devotional service.
Na naam rupe guna janma karma bhir.
Na naam rupe guna janma karma bhir.
Nirupitavye tava tasya sakshina.
Nirupitavye tava tasya sakshina.
Your transcendental name and form are not ascertained by those who merely speculate on the path of imagination. Your name, form, and attributes can be ascertained only through devotional service.
Sriman Grinan Samsmarayam Stachintayam.
Sriman Grinan Samsmarayam.
Engage in various activities, devotees whose minds are completely absorbed at your lotus feet and who constantly hear, chant, contemplate, and cause others to remember your transcendental names and forms are always on the transcendental platform, and thus they can understand the Supreme Personality of Godhead.
Dishya Haresha Bhavata Padubho.
Dishya Haresha Bhavata Padubho.
Bharo Panita Stava Janmaneshitu.
Bharo Panita Stava Janmaneshitu.
Dishyan Kitam Tvat Padakeshu Shobhanair.
Dishyan Kitam Tvat.
O Lord, we are fortunate because the heavy burden of the demons upon this earth is immediately removed by your appearance. Indeed, we are certainly fortunate, for we shall be able to see upon this earth and in the heavenly planets the marks of lotus, conch shell, club and disc that adorn your lotus feet.
Nate bhavashesha bhavasya karanam.
Nate bhavashesha bhavasya karanam.
Vina vinodam pata tarkayamahe.
Vina vinodam pata tarkayamahe.
Bhava nirodashtiti apyavadhyaya.
O Supreme Lord, you are not an ordinary living entity appearing in this material world as a result or fruit of activities. Therefore, your appearance or birth in this world has no other cause than your pleasure potency. Similarly, the living entities who are part of you have no cause for miseries like birth, death, and old age, except when these living entities are conducted by your external energy.
Matsya Shvakachapa Nrsimha Varaha Hamsa.
Matsya Shvakachapa Nrsimha Varaha Hamsa.
Rajanya Vipra Vibhudesh Krita Vatara.
Rajanya Vipra Vibhudesh Krita Vatara.
Supreme Controller, your Lordship previously appeared, accepted incarnations as a fish, a horse, a tortoise, Narasimhadev, a boar, a swan, Lord Ramachandra, Parishuram, and among the demigods Vamanadev, to protect the entire world by your mercy. Now, please protect us again by your mercy, by diminishing the disturbances in this world. O Krishna, best of the Yadus, we respectfully offer our obeisances unto you.
Dishyamate kukshikata parapama.
Dishyamate kukshikata parapama.
Amshena shakshat bhagavan bhavayana.
Amshena shakshat bhagavan bhavayana.
Mahudvayam boja patir mumosho.
Mahudvayam boja patir mumosho.
Bhottaya dunam bhavita tvatmaja.
Bhottaya dunam bhavita tvatmaja.
O Mother Deviki, by your good fortune and ours, the Supreme Personality of Godhead himself, with all his plenary portions, such as Baladev, is now within your womb. Therefore you need not fear Kamsa, who has decided to be killed by the Lord. Your eternal son, Krishna, will be the protector of the entire Yadu dynasty.
Jaya Radha Gopi Natara.
Thank you.
Shri Radha Gopinath ki Jai. Shri Jagannath Baladev Subhadra Maharani ki Jai. Shri Shri Gaur Nithai ki Jai. Shri Laubhar ki Jai. Yashmati Nandana Brajabaranagara Gokula Ranjana Kana. Yashamati Nandana Brajabaranagara Gokula Ranjana Kana. Gopi Parangadhana Madana Manohara Parangadhana Madana Manohara Kaliya Gamana Vidhana Kaliya Gamana Vidhana Gopina Purandara Navena Garabara Bamsi Badana Suvasa Purandara Navina Garabara Bamsi Badana Suvasa Yasamati Nandana Braja Paranadara Gokula Rangana Kana Yasamati Nandana Braja Paranadara Gokula Rangana Kana Braja Jana Palana Sura Kula Nasana Nanda Godhana Rakhwala Bolo Nanda Gopala Sundara Nanda Gopala Bolo Yashomati Nanda Raja Varanagara Gokula Rangana Kana Jabarana Jarago Yashomati Nandana Brajabarana Jarago Gokula Ranjana Kana Gokula Ranjana Kana Tatara Gopi Pasanahara Narhara Sita Kripa Moya Bolo Yamuna Tatara Gopi Pasanahara Narhara Sita Kripa Moya Radha Vallabha Vrindavana Nata Bara Radha Vallabha Vrindavana Nata Bara Bhakti Vinota Saya Bhakti Vinota Saya
Rasa Mati Nandana Vajabara Nagara Gokula Rangana Kana Bolo Yasa Mati Nandana Vajabara Nagara Gokula Rangana Kana Yashomati Nandana Prajabara Nagara Yashomati Nandana Prajabara Nagara Gokula Rangana Kana Gokula Rangana Kana Yashomati Nandana Prajabara Nagara Gokula Rangana Kana Yashomati Nandana Gokula Yashomati Nandana Prajabara Nagara Gokula Rangana Kana Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare. Hare 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 Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Krishna, 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 Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama. Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare, Hare. Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Radha Gopinath Se Radhe, Hare Radha Gopinath, Radha Gopinath, Radha Gopinath Se Radhe. Jaya Jagannath, Jaya Jagannath, Jaya Baladev, Jaya Subhadra. Jaya Jagannath, Jaya Jagannath, Jaya Baladev, Jaya Subhadra. Gauranita, Jaya Gauranita, Gauranita, Shishi Gauranita. Jaya Gauranita, Jaya Gauranita, Gauranita, Shishi Gauranita. Jaya Jaya Prabhupada, 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 Jaya Jaya Prabhupada, Jaya Jaya Prabhupada, Jaya Jaya Prabhupada, 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 Jaya Jaya Prabhupada. Guru Re, 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 Guru Re,
Krishna Janmastami Mahotsav ki jai. Vitai Gaur Pramananda Virgo.
Thank you. Radha Madhava Kunja Vihari.
Asto Tarasata Divine Grace, Esi Bhaktivedanta Swami, Shira Prabhupada Ki Jaya, Iskandhiti Foundaracharya Shira Prabhupada Ki Jaya, Anantikoti Vaishnavrinda Ki Jaya, Namachari Shri Haridas Thakur Ki Jaya, Prem Sagaho Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadha Shri Vasani Gaura Bhaktivedanta Ki Jaya, Shri Shri Radha Krishna Gopa Gopinath Shyamakund Radhakund Giri Govardhan Ki Jaya, Vrindavan Dham Ki Jaya, Navadvip Mayapur Dham Ki Jaya, Jagannath Puri Dham Ki Jaya, Gangamaya Ki Jaya, Muna Devi Ki Jaya, Shrimati Tulsi Maharani Ki Jaya, Shri Bhakti Devi Ki Jaya, Shri Krishna Janmastami Mahamahotsava Ki
Jaya,
Go Premanandi, all glories to the assembled devotees, all glories to the assembled devotees, all glories to the assembled devotees, all glories to Shri Guru and Shri Gaurangi, glories to Shri just technology play a game with us, play along. So I guess, as a few devotees have done already, we wish each other a wonderful Janmastami. And Janmastami is not any other day, we know that for sure, but it's also not any other festival. And I can't remember who I was talking with yesterday. And as devotees, we may have certain preferences, certain tastes, inclinations. That's perfectly acceptable in bhakti yoga. But Janmastami still reigns king. If we ever say, Gopani is my favorite festival, Shiva Chattadashi, or coming up next, Radhastami is my favorite festival. That's nice. But when you turn to Shastra, which is what we're about, we are, for anything, we're trained by Srila Prabhupada always to think, what does it say in the Shastra? Shastra glorifies Janmastami, very, very much so. And to start, I have a few verses to confirm this. These are from the Hari Bhakti Vilas. O great sage, I have not seen anything in the Vedas or the Puranas equal to or better than the vow of Shri Krishna Janmastami. O best of Brahmins, when he sees a self-controlled person observing the vow of Janmastami, Yamaraj, his face turned white, at once erases what is written of him. So Yamaraj is right there now with his duster over his chalkboard or his whiteboard marker, wiping it all out. It has not been done already, of course. So. It is also said, a person who would have vowed worships Lord Krishna and Devaki, leaves the horrible path to Yamaloka and goes to the supreme abode of Lord Vishnu. O sage, a person who at the moment of his death remembers Lord Krishna attains perfection. In the same way, when a person follows the vow of Janmastami, all he has done becomes perfect. Therefore, by my order, please observe the vow of Janmastami and thus attain liberation from this world of birth and death. In the Brahmakanda, after describing the glories of this vow, Sri Suta Goswami says, thus I have described the glories of the Sri Krishna Janmastami vow, which is very confidential and hidden in all the scriptures. By once hearing this description, a person becomes free from all his sins. At the end of his body, he goes to the world of Lord Krishna.
Can you explain what the vow of Janmastami is?
Well, actually, just as we, I think, let's have a look. What is the vow of Janmastami? See, do we know what the vow of Janmastami is? And I hope we get it right. We've all done a few. So, what is this? What would you think is the vow of Janmastami?
Fasting and celebrating.
Okay. But in which order? Because this morning, actually, in my announcements, I said, there's a strange rumour that goes around about Janmastami. And we've all heard this rumour. Something about fasting? What fasting? Janmastami is all-day feasting.
You feast, feast, and more feast on hearing and chanting about Krishna. And because you're doing that, you kind of go, oh my God, I didn't eat today. I didn't, oh my God, I just like, well, oh yeah, I forgot, I normally do that, don't I? But today, because I'm feasting so much on Krishna, it's just, and that's to me what Janmastami is definitely all about. We, as much as possible, we stay directly with the deities and hear and chant for the pleasure of our worshipable deities. Oh yeah, and then the side thing about the fasting is like, it's like it just passes our attention. But I was thinking of, that's going to hurry back to Vilas, but even the Nectar of Devotion, which is our book, Bhakti Rasa Mrita, written by Sri Rupa Goswami, the 64 principles of devotional service, and one of them is
celebrating
Janmastami, yeah. And this is Rupa Goswami saying it. He doesn't actually mention celebrating Gaur Purnima. And Rupa Goswami, directly the line of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, directly. So, even as I said, even if you have that preference, that's very nice. But Janmastami reigns supreme. It is really given. Everything should be done as much as possible to embrace the wonderful day that Janmastami is. And my topic today was the wonder of Krishna. I say most of us here have many Janmastamis under our belt, and who have many times had our sinful reactions wiped clean. But a challenge for all of us is to keep always the wonder of these things. And I also remember my very first Janmastami. It left such a deep impression. And it was in Seoul Street in, I can't remember the exact year, 1991. And I just was coming along, didn't understand much, and I did the whole fasting thing. So at midnight, when those curtains opened, and I think I saw the Lord, but what I definitely saw was yes, this ocean everywhere of food. I probably didn't even know the word prasad at that point. Food. But it's Krishna's prasad. So I literally like swooned that moment. And I said, the most beautiful thing I'd ever seen, and I don't think I've ever reproduced it. That just the beauty of it was like so. The colors, and you've never seen so much food arranged so beautifully. And it's never been the same since. It's never been. What happened? What happened? Go back to Shins. He was really absorbed in the wonder of everything. And then the old das came along and whatever about Brahman. And then maybe that some of the wonder maybe seems to disappear. And therefore our battle, our determination is to not lose that. That first time we met a devotee, God, oh, they're so nice. The first time you had prasad and you're going, oh, what was that? The first time you danced in kirtan and thought, my God, I want to do this the rest of my life. And fast forward a few years, we're thinking, when will this stop the kirtan? Or I wish they weren't playing like that. Of this prasad, God, they call this prasad? So we tend to change our attitude a bit. So maybe some of it is practical and some of it has grounds to it. But we should really stay strong on this point of the wonder of it all. The wonder of the devotees, the wonder of the deities, the wonder of kirtan, the wonder of prasad. It has a technical name. Adbhuta Bhakti Ras. Rupa Goswami gives this. This is of the different the five primary rasas and seven secondary rasas. This is a secondary ras. Prabhupada directly used the word astonishment. The astonishment. Adbhuta, he always says amazing. So Adbhuta Bhakti Ras. And it comes and three primary ones by seeing Narada Muni. So, as I tend to do, anybody think of the example of Narada Muni in this Adbhuta Bhakti Ras, the main example of when he was, wow, he had his wow moment. And it's pretty easy, so I'm hoping somebody, Narada Muni's main wow moment. No.
When he saw Krishna the first time, it was a pretty wow moment.
Yeah, that's true, but a little later on. Okay, I'll give you a hint. There's a whole chapter dedicated to it.
And Lord Rama sent him first time to Earth. You meet Lord Rama and then he and then Lord?
Not directly, no. Somebody else has a suggestion? A whole chapter called after this.
For the games were in the afternoon.
Now the games. I'm games all along the paper road. Shishanagopala, Shishaki Ki, Jagan Bhagavan, Sivanta Marani Ki, Shishigonitai Ki. Yes, thank you. When Dwarka, when Narada Muni visits Krishna in Dwarka, right, and he's constantly, there's mention he's in the main. Here's Krishna, and then he's in this palace, and he's in 16,000 in that palace, and this palace is doing this, and this is doing. Well, now I'm just nodding back here. Oh yeah, you that one. So, and it said he was really, even though those moments were maybe there, but he was freshly, like, wowed by Krishna. How much Narada Muni is our topmost acharya? Always absorbed in Krishna, but still he was having this fresh excitement. How amazing Krishna is, like, and he's doing this here, and he's giving his ranging marriages and playing games and spending with his wife, and each palace is doing something different. But it's the same Krishna.
Wow.
So this example Rupa Goswami gives, not only seeing. By hearing Maharaj Parikshit, he has an amazing moment. Cool, very more specific. Oh my God, actually, you know, so yeah.
Krishna in the womb?
Krishna in the womb? No, not directly.
But actually, I'm not in the
darkness. Okay. It's when Mark Prickshit he hears about. What was it now? Okay. Kali Yuga, let's thank you. We have some notes to fall back on. And the third one, where I'm looking at this, is by speaking Lord Brahma. She didn't take it down. There we go. Didn't take it down. Lord Brahma. That doesn't make sense. Stealing the coward boys. Right? Makes more sense. Stealing the coward boys. And he takes the boys and runs and hides them off to the cave, and then comes back and sees them all there. And of course he thinks it's only a moment, but it's been a whole year. But Lord Brahma, like all the demigods, do what everyone else does, and he goes back to his Satyaloka, He tells everybody. He never guessed what just happened. And when he's telling everybody, I stole all the cowboys, and they went back, and they were all still there. And they looked just like the boys, but then they turned into the Lord. They looked just like him, but then it was the Lord. And then when he appeared as the Lord, and this is kind of similar to another instance, all these other Brahmas appeared. And I saw all these other Brahmas, and they were much bigger than me. And much more heads and more great. So when he was telling this, he was reliving it. So the other demigods he was telling it to, well, they were going, wow. But the example Goswami was giving, when he had just been through it, but by telling the story again, he was reliving. And he felt great astonishment in how Krishna had manifested such amazing abilities. I can't remember. The picture was the demon. Is demon related about two? Maybe it's not. I can't remember. Anyway, you may look it up. I'll have a look at myself. Now again, it's in Rupa Goswami. It's the example he gives. And Prabhupada mentions an extra devotion. But these are the examples of by directly seeing and by hearing and by speaking, we can all enter this mood of the wonder of Krishna. And by seeing him and by hearing about him, and actually Prabhupada elaborates on this point, how even if you don't experience something, by hearing from the great devotees, then you can also directly experience it. And who was recently, was it in class? Who was glorifying when you hear Srila Prabhupada speak? Devotees heard Prabhupada speak, it was if as they were there. As if they were in, especially when Prabhupada didn't do it so often, but when he told a pastime and he did a voice, Prabhupada put the voice on and he would voice Krishna, and said it was just as if you could hear the eternal personality speaking to Krishna. Even though Prabhupada didn't put on, he didn't change his voice too much, but you got the presence of that person in Srila Prabhupada's voice, in the way he said it. And the devotee said this, so this by hearing from Prabhupada, who was obviously, as we accept, directly always in Krishna's presence and pastimes, you also got this wonderful mood. And we hear that too, right, when Prabhupada had his moments of when it just came across the surface, his internal ecstasy, the devotee said the whole room becomes so charged by Prabhupada. You get a glimpse of the spiritual world by Prabhupada's suddenly manifesting that. And he said he didn't do it too often. And then Prabhupada finishes that section on astonishment with this. The activities of a person, even if they are not very extraordinary, create an impression of wonder in the heart and mind of the person's friends. But even very wonderful activities performed by a person who is not one's friend will not create any impression. It is because of the love that one's wonderful activities create an impression in the mind. So it's not so much the activity. And sometimes we hear this about Krishna, right? Who says, oh, it's not so wonderful, he's Krishna. But no, it's really wonderful that he's doing this because he is Krishna. He's performing, especially human-like pastimes. How could it, why would the Supreme Person perform such wonderful pastimes? But our ability to be in this mood of wonder, to appreciate it, is based upon love. And we definitely see that on a very practical level with people we know, right? We can hear, oh, do you have so-and-so, this person did this wonderful achievement. But if you don't know them, you go, all right, okay, that's interesting. But if you hear about a friend of yours and they just achieved this, immediately you're interested, you're whoa, wow, that's really amazing. When you see the person, you're excited to share it because of relationship, because of love. The mood, the ability to be astonished is based upon to the degree that we love. So Krishna's activities, whatever they are, from his sweet Vrindavan pastimes to his chivalrous pastimes at the battlefield to his kingly pastimes in Dwarka, we should all be stimulated to be a mood of astonishment how wonderful Krishna is. And Prabhupada would give that as a barometer also. If somehow or other we're thinking, when we hear Krishna's Vrindavan pastimes, we go, that's so sweet, it's so nice. Should we automatically assume that's a spiritual emotion? Should we? Just because it's a little baby and he's running in the mud and he's holding on coward tails and he's breaking butt. It's naturally enchanting. But is it necessarily, can we assume that we're spiritually enchanted with the right spiritual source of this emotion? One way to know is that when you hear about Krishna killing the demons, Krishna fighting, you're also just as much eager. Prabhupada said, what he would sometimes say, these people, they just want to hear Krishna's conjugal and childhood pastimes, but what about Krishna killing the demons? I mean, I think he mentioned simply on the battlefield. We should be just as eager. And if we're not, then we have to question our eagerness. We have to question our eagerness, because for us, everything should be exciting about Krishna, if there is some love. I have a few... Oh yeah. I was thinking, this is... Sometimes, especially when we hear Bhagavatam class, this is how we should be. Hey, Abhu, would you like to sit down and read Krishna book? Wow! Yeah! Did you hear this about Krishna? No, I didn't hear that about Krishna. Wow, this is... So this is... Picture this in next time whenever you're... Yeah, and we shouldn't be like... Not like this guy.
Life is sucking,
yeah. Well, this is taken in a Srimad Bhagavatam class. And this is a face one tends to see a lot throughout Bhagavatam classes in ISKCON. Oh, I wish he'd hurry up, but can he finish soon? A month back. God, this speaker is so boring. So, let's be not like this little character. And I always say, I like to emphasize, is we tend to have overemphasized in ISKCON about the qualification of the other person. And we do this in ISKCON very much traditionally by the qualification of the cook, as opposed to the qualification of the eater, and the qualification of the speaker, as opposed to the qualification of the hearer. Yes. So I'm trying to get away now here with my obviously lack of disqualification to speak. And putting all the responsibility on you, the qualified hearers. But it really is the platform of Madhyama Bhakta, the Madhyama Adhikari. He's always thinking about my responsibility, not the other person's responsibility. I'm responsible for my own situation. I'm responsible, not whatever about the speaker. Because as long as he's speaking bona fide Bhagavatam, Bhagavad Gita, I should be astonished. I should be enlivened by it. And not be thinking about their lack of disqualification, or think about my lack of disqualification and how I should be hearing better. And this is how we will grow. I actually, in preparing for yesterday's our Q&A tent on the epics, one point I read about Duryodhana I'd never noticed before, and how, as Govinda and Chaitanya Mahaprabhu point out, the Mahabharata and Ramayana, we should really present them as very relevant to the present time. They're not something that's old and distant. And they're not. They're so much not like that. And one example that I hadn't thought before was Duryodhan blaming Yudhisthira. Duryodhan spent his whole life in this frustration and anger and pain and this. And why? He got the kingdom. He was in control of it. He got people's, here he got people's respect. Actually, here he wasn't a bad king. But what was his problem? Yudhisthira. Yudhisthira. It's always him. Why was he born first? Yudhisthira. Because of him. And actually, it's pretty much Duryodhana meditation, kill all the Pandavas, but principally get Yudhisthira. Because he was the one. It's his fault that I can't be king. His fault. And because he spent his whole life blaming someone else for his situation, he spent his whole life suffering. And how much we also can see that. By blaming someone else for our suffering, we're the ones that suffer. And there's a nice example when even Dhritarashtra tells Maharaj Yudhisthira, Dhritarashtra tells Duryodhana, look, you have so much. Dhritarashtra always played this like he was, he knew about Krishna, he knew what the right thing to do, but he always made the wrong choice because it was attached to his sons. So sometimes we preach to Duryodhana, please, my son, be happy, you have so much. And Duryodhana goes, I want to be dissatisfied. So what can you do? Somebody wants to be dissatisfied, you can do nothing, because he was always dissatisfied that he wasn't older than you, so he wasn't first. So let's try not be spend our life suffering because we're blaming others and the responsibility for our lack of, for our miseries or our lack of taste. Of course, this is to quote this verse because Srila Prabhupada always quoted in reference to Krishna's appearance. Janma karma chame divyam. Actually, let's quote it as the verse. Janma karma chame divyam. Elam yom levati tatvata. Drakhalati amakuna janma. Naiti mame disorjuna. One who knows the transcendent nature of my appearance and activities does not, upon leaving the body, take his birth again in this material world, but attains my eternal abode, O Krishna. And we're always fascinated by the... We're always fascinated by the simplicity of this verse. Simply, who knows the appearance and activities. And we all know about the appearance and activities, right? If I asked anybody here, I said, yeah, Krishna, I'm in prison, appeared, Vasudev, and transferred to Devaki. But one meditation we have at festivals in this mood of trying to increase our abhuta bhakti ras is that if I said now, who here has heard of the pastime of Krishna killing Putin? Show of hands, who here has heard?
You're all wrong.
You've never heard it. If you think you've heard something about Krishna's pastimes, it means you've never heard it at all. I was thinking, this is, actually I kind of use this in festivals a lot to awaken our appreciation of festivals. Krishna's pastimes, what to speak, we hear about this about the holy name, right? We all chant, almost 16 hours of holy name, repeat the same, the mantra however many times. It said, each time you say Hare or Krishna, Hare Krishna, it's different because it is Krishna. Krishna is free from any stagnation. There's no such thing as every time you encounter Krishna, he's different. Every single second. So with his pastimes, if we think we've heard the pastime, it means you've never, because if you really heard it, you entered into it. This is how Krishna and his name and his pastimes are non-different. And this is one of the reasons we're told not to go too far into pastimes that we're not qualified to hear about. Because you, to some degree, you enter into it if you're doing it correctly. So, and when you enter into it, it's different every time. Right? I think most of us experience that. And at the back, the Bhagavad Gita, that, who was it, Gandhi's quote? Or that one quote put at the back of the Bhagavad Gita. Every time I read it, it's different and fresh. Right? Whose quote is that? I forget whose quote.
Thoreau.
Was it Thoreau's quote?
Was it? My intellect and its vendors and cosmogony. Philosophy, Gita, compared to which all literature seems puny and trivial.
Okay, very nice, thank you. So even Thoreau appreciated the freshness of the Bhagavad Gita. So to speak of us, how we have to approach it in a fresh way, and when we hear about Krishna's pastimes, because when you approach it in the right consciousness, you all should have a wow moment. Why? I just never noticed that before. I never heard it before. Even though I'm reading the same thing. And specifically my spiritual master, Swami Sasrut Maharaj, addressed this in specifically Krishna's pastimes with the Bhagavad Gita even more so. We definitely have to address this problem we have of thinking, oh yeah, I know the Bhagavad Gita so many times. But then you haven't really read Bhagavad Gita. Because that attitude, that meditation won't be there. Because if you read it, you exchange with Krishna, and you left with so much happiness in being in his presence, in his association. And next time you're excited. You're excited to go to it again. So when we hear Krishna's pastimes, we should always approach it, because we have the tendency to think, I've heard it before. We should remind ourselves, no, let me think, I've never heard this before. And then it helps us enter the fresh way. How about like the residents of Vrindavan? When Krishna gets up and the cowboys come to his door, Krishna comes out, the cowboys going, Krishna, what are we going to do today? Krishna says, we're going to go to the forest. The cowboys going, the forest. What forest? Vrindavan. Yashishirada Gopinath Vishakti Ki, Jagabalaya Subhadamarani Ki, Jigonitai Ki. To the cowboys going, oh, come on, can we go to a different forest? Any of you imagine that ever being the case? No. They're every day, even though it's just we're going to the forest, we're going to herd cows, we're going to play games, we're going to steal each other's lunches, we're going to throw a ball, we're going to run, we're going to dress up, we're going to call the animals different names, and every time it's completely first time. Every time it's the first time. This is Vrindavan consciousness. This is the consciousness we have to aspire for. So if we ever thinking, am I ready to go back to Vrindavan? If we see ourselves approaching, hearing Krishna passions like this, this is like the first time. And it's the best time ever. And I haven't heard it before. It's never been like this. This is the best. This is the nicest. So we have to aspire, as we're told, to follow the footsteps of the residents of Vrindavan, to aspire to have such excitement when we hear about Krishna, Bhuta Bhakti. And that's why this appearance of the activities, this is not a shallow thing, just repeat it. What does it really mean to have really absorbed in Krishna's, in how merciful it is that he's come to this world to pick us up? I really appreciate that. And for me, of course, as I've mentioned a few times already, this Janmastami is really about Krishna book. It really should be about Krishna book. Because this is our source of Krishna's pastimes. And particularly nowadays, when we have so many other sources we can turn to on Janmastami, we should really turn to Krishna book. And that was particularly done by Srila Prabhupada himself, of course. And there's, I think, at least three recorded Janmastamis where Prabhupada says, open up Krishna book, let's hear. And there's the famous New Vrindavan one. Have you ever heard the New Vrindavan story? When there was, I think, 74, quite a little late, 75, and there's quite a few sannyasis. And it was like, towards the end of the day, 9 o'clock, 10 o'clock, the Prabhupada said, open Krishna book and read the appearance of Krishna, prayers by the demigods, Kamsa's atrocities. And as soon as the reader would come to the end of a chapter, devotees would go, how do you go? And Prabhupada would go, next chapter? Next chapter? And it was at 9 o'clock, 10 o'clock, 11 o'clock, 12 o'clock, half 12, 1 o'clock. And I'm not sure, I can't remember exactly what time it went on to, but Prabhupada went on real late. He wasn't thinking, okay, it's 12 o'clock, let's break the fast. And he must have heard this about the dandas. At the front, of course, all the swamis were up there with the dandas. And at the back, the devotees could see, all they could see the whole time was the dandas going. And there's like quite a lot of dandas, like 8 or 9 dandas, and they're all, so you could see them. So all the big swamis were up there also struggling like anything, sitting from the Prabhupada. And they just, and everybody could admit, they didn't have it. They don't have it. Here we are, we're just thinking, when will he please stop? And Prabhupada was just, keep going, keep going, keep going, keep going. So this is Prabhupada's book. This is, of course, all the Prabhupada's books are special without a shadow of a doubt. But this is a really, really extra special mercy, you could say. Because Bhagavad Gita is to pull you out of the material world. This is to bring you straight back to Goloka Vrindavan. And as I was discussing actually with one devotee, and even yesterday in our question and answer session, somebody was asking about Radha Krishna Lila. And I said, yeah, it's there, but are you ready? And he was going, yeah, I'm ready. And I said, well, do you have any attraction to anything aside from Krishna? Yeah. Then you're not ready. Then you're not ready. And Prabhupada made it very clear, that barometer. If you have any interest in anything separate from Krishna, then be careful. This is the science. You're not ready to hear intimate Radha Krishna pastimes. But yet Prabhupada gave us the Krishna book, which has Krishna's childhood pastimes, has Radha Krishna Lila. But he presented in such an empowered way that us with so little to no qualification can access it, can access these pastimes. And this is the book we know we're safe with. We know we are safe. We know we are solid. And once you go to any other book, question. And even Shiva Maharaj himself addressed this point in his Krishna Vrindavan series. He had released 3 books, Vinayagita, Krishna Sangita, and Pariyaham. And devotees kept asking Maharaj this question, should I be reading this? And Maharaj says, of course, because Shiva Maharaj being the wonderful stalwart devotee he is, he also presented in a very careful way, very particular. But then, even still, after producing those 3 books, he produced another book, and that was his biggest book, Sudabhakti Chintamani, about how to know, to answer this question, how do you know if you're ready? And it's a big book. A very, very elaborate book based on Bhakti Rasa and Sindhu and Prabhupada's Nectar and Devotion. How to know, how to see yourself if you're ready to hear these pastimes. The very deep science about this. But with your Krishna book, you don't need. You can just open up Krishna book and start hearing directly about Krishna. So today, we will try to, and even spend this morning, time-wise and devotees' patience, we should hear as much as possible from Krishna book and chant Hare Krishna. I thought I'd put up a talking here. Okay, so then quickly, it's just a little thing. We hear about, in the Chaitanya Charitamrita, we hear about the reasons for Lord Krishna's, Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's descent. But there's also reasons for Krishna's descent. Anybody quickly? There's internal and external. There's three external reasons for Krishna's descent. Yeah, that covers two, which is two. And?
Reestablish religious principles.
And? Protect the demons. So, to decrease the burden of the earth by killing the demons, to attract self-realized sages, words slightly different, and to give his devotees his pastimes to remember and attract others to him. So, he said that when Krishna does these things, it's not so much directly for the activity, it's just to give us the chance to hear about these pastimes. When we hear in Shrivabhagavatam, when Krishna left, he didn't leave. And somebody asked that question, when Krishna left, what about this? I said, what does Krishna mean? Krishna never left. Krishna never leave. First of all, he can't leave. Even that's a mundane concept, leaving, because it's Krishna. It's Krishna's energy. He doesn't see it as something he leaves. Even that is not our philosophy or topic. But he becomes unmanifest. He becomes unmanifest in a certain situation. But when Krishna became unmanifest after his Bhoma Leela, he manifested here as Srimad Bhagavatam. And that Srimad Bhagavatam is Krishna. And then he left all these pastimes for us to come along, to hear about. And then there's also internal reasons. And you want to give, I think we've got two internal reasons. Krishna can. You make a good Krishna conscious guess, it's okay. And specifically?
To increase prayer book.
Close. Another example, what are the devotees?
The Pandavas.
The Gopis.
Janmastami, there's a nice Bhakti Brihad Bhagavad Maharaj. One time he gave a Janmastami talk and said, Janmastami is for the non-devotees. I was like, what Maharaj? I never heard that before. It's for the non-devotees. Because in the spiritual world, is there a Janmastami?
No,
don't you master. So, there's the clue. So, who does Krishna come to reciprocate with?
Jesus.
Non-devotees.
But we're internal here. We're internal. Come on. Janmastami.
Birth.
Who's he take birth from?
His parents.
Yes. Thank you. And what parents?
Both.
Well, both. There's only two sets. But of course, actually, it specifically mentioned, of course, Nandini Yashoda. Because even though Krishna takes birth from Vasudeva and Devaki, it actually is to reciprocate with Yashoda and Nanda. To have these childhood pastimes that aren't here, there in the spiritual world. This is when Krishna comes here, he has these pastimes. To have this portion of his exchange with Yashoda and Nanda, and also to bring the Sringara Rasa to the material world, his topmost behavior, intimate pastimes with the gopis of Vrindavan. So to, as Prabhupada would often say simply, so to attract us from our own attempts to imitate these pastimes with the dancing of boys and girls, probably said dancing. So to get us away from this, Krishna comes and shows how he dances and how the pleasure he takes and how we should aspire to engage with that. So here is actually, I want to hear a little bit from Srila Prabhupada, and here is he's talking very animatedly about Vrindavan and Krishna's pastime. Oh, I didn't even speak up. Sure. Okay, hopefully you'll be able to hear it and you can read along.
Krishna, this is the thing about law, you see Krishna in Jindra, with the gopis, with the cow, with the friends, in Vrindavan, in the forest, with cow, with calf. This is Jindra. Paradise. Jiva is enjoyment? No. Jiva is not enjoyment. Anandamayam Vyasa, this is the Vedanta Sutra. That the absolute truth personality of Godhead is simply enjoying. Everything is enjoying. You find Krishna always, wherever he is playing on flute with company, as a gopi, a coward boy, or somebody. Oh, this is enjoying. And he comes personally on this planet to show his enjoyment life. In Vrindavan, that place in Vrindavan. That Vrindavan is so important. Mm. So invite us that why you are rotting here, come with me and join with my dance. Similarly, Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu also, you see, dance. Yeah. Sri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Dittananda, Sri Advaita Gadadhara, old dance, Samapanasa Pata. So then life is this, enjoyment, dance, that is life. And not meditation. For 15 minutes meditation, I become God. These are all aspects. Enjoyment is real life. Enjoyment, that enjoyment, not this material, as they said, no, above, transcendent. That we find information in Krishna consciousness. So I am very glad that you have all taken. Continue this Krishna consciousness, read books, chant, dance, eat nicely, and be happy. Thank you very much.
So I must say, it's a beautiful little. It's an exceptionally nice quote because Prabhupada like invites you to Vrindavan. Why are you here in this rotten world? I mean, Prabhupada's ability to like immediately connect how he wants to get in our heads. This is a rotting world and you're rotting in it, and pretty much we find we're rotting as well. We're rotten. And you just go to Vrindavan, be with Krishna. This is replay. This is enjoyment, to dance with Krishna. And there's another famous time Prabhupada said, eat, sleep, drink and be merry, everything with Krishna. This is why he saw. And so he would give it in such a, because you can feel, that's why it's always nice to hear Prabhupada, you can hear his calling, his Krishna's calling. And so Prabhupada was representing this call, come back and taste this real enjoyment. There's a very famous, in early 66, even before 26 Second Avenue, when he was still in there, but I think it was actually Dr. Mishra's ashram, and he's given those talks to people who aren't even any followers yet. And he's saying, I came from Vrindavan, and I am missing this Vrindavan. And there's one lady there goes, I know. It's like, you know, what? And Prabhupada goes, yes, I am missing this Vrindavan. I am thinking, where is this, where is my Vrindavan? So you can probably get a glimpse of his sacrifice that he made to come here and bring to us Vrindavan.
But I skipped this quote because I want to...
Okay, I'll read this one quickly because it's very much in this mood of the wonder. On another occasion, the coward boys were surrounded by fire. Not knowing anyone else but Krishna, they immediately called for him and Krishna was ready. Yes. Thus Krishna immediately swallowed the whole fire. There were many demons that attacked the boys, and every day the boys would return to their homes, to the mothers, and say, Mother, Krishna is so wonderful. And they would explain what had happened that day. And the mothers would say,
yes.
Okay, thank you, Donaldi. Yes, our Krishna is wonderful. They did not know that Krishna is God, the Supreme Person. They only knew that Krishna is wonderful, that's all. And the more they perceived Krishna's wonderful activities, the more their love increased. Perhaps he may be a demigod, they thought. When Nanda Maharaj, Krishna's father, talked among his friends, the friends would talk about Krishna and say, "Oh, Nanda Maharaj, your child Krishna is wonderful." And Nanda Maharaj would respond, "Yes, I see that. Maybe he is some demigod." And even then, even that was not certain. Maybe demigod. Could be, he's my son. So this constant freshness and wonder that the residents in Vrindavan have, that we have to get on board with. And this is how we will stay. At least in our practice of Krishna consciousness. And it's up to Krishna if we get Krishna consciousness or not. But staying in our practice, will we stay in this mood of wonder? Because it's when we stop in this mood of wonder and astonishment, then we fall down to our natural state of being offensive, basically. Who are we to be with the thief? Who are we to be with such exalted persons? Who are we to eat the Lord's remnants? What qualification do I have? But yet I'm doing it. So if I don't embrace this mood of wonder, it becomes complacent and therefore offensive, and therefore there's where the devotee stops at practice. And a good example of this wonder was when Krishna appeared directly in the prison to Vasudeva and Devaki. And there's an example given of four ways Vasudeva was really embracing this mood of wonder. Anybody remember, I think, any of the ways Vasudev manifested this mood of wonder?
When the shackles broke, when the doors were open, when the guards were falling asleep.
Okay, on his way out, everything just happened, magically happened, yeah. But even before that, actually still in the prison cell itself, there's at least four examples given.
When Krishna changed his form from Vishnu form to
Krishna. Well, even, you pretty much got it, but what's even the first point you said? Because when Krishna first appeared,
he appeared with the
hands.
The hand. And specifically, the hair. Because Prabhupada points that out. Even though children are born with some hair, right? And usually there's some. But he had a full head of beautiful hair, dressed in all the ornaments and garments and everything. So, who appears like this? Who appears? It would be fairly strange if a child appeared. But this is Krishna, he appears. So yes, so he appeared in this beautiful form. What else? What other example did Vasudev embrace him with wonder?
The
yoga party? Well, even just still in the prison cell itself, there's four examples of other examples of Vasudev having manifested like his wow. Any ideas?
Maybe because he appeared with four-handed
form. Yeah. Yeah, we have it. That's the first one, the way the appearance of the Lord.
Is there something about them becoming effulgent or something like that?
They became effulgent before, yes. But Vasudeva and Devaki, when Krishna was in the womb, yeah, she became extra effulgent and cancer. But actually, it's an appearance.
Subhadra? Did she appear?
No, not directly. Because she appeared from the shoulder.
Kamsha was there and then.
That comes later, but just on the exact appearance, for example.
Krishna would appear before them.
Yes. What? Yes, he raises the question of
why me?
Why us? Yeah, that, how they appear for us. And not just David and Vasudev, but what was their situation?
In jail.
They're in jail. Yeah, Vasudev, like, the Lord's appearing in a prison cell? This is God, this is like, where's the glory in that? In a prison cell. So Vasudev was appreciating how Krishna is appearing in a prison cell. That Krishna is willing to take birth in Kamsa's prison. Although the Lord is often vain, he's appeared in the womb of Devaki. This is one of them. Is that the Lord? Because we hear first, and it's interesting, Ras goes on between Vasudeva, Devaki, and Krishna. They have this mood of philosophy, but especially Devaki, she makes this strange conclusion. She glorifies him, you are the Supreme Person, and you are all powerful. But then she draws what conclusion? What does she tell Krishna to do when he's in the Vasudeva form? She tells him to
hide his form.
Why?
She's afraid of him.
She's afraid Kamsa might do something. So, you just glorify him. So, did she just forget all the philosophy? Yes, she did. And why did she? She's a mother. So it's interesting. That's why Devaki and Nipunji, you showed in Devaki. There's no mother showed her. Does she go there at all? No, she never goes there. She never goes there. And actually the next example out is Queen Kunti. Queen Kunti also appreciates Krishna, but she stays in that mood of reverential mood. And Devaki Manaji kind of, she says it, but then she goes, but please, this nonsense demon's coming, he might try to hurt you, so please take this form so he doesn't recognize you. So the philosophy goes and her mood, her ras comes out, which is what it's all about. That a child can take birth fully decorated from the womb, got that, and that his worshipful Lord has taken birth as his son. He recognizes this Lord and said, this has been me for me, his son? This is unheard of. How could it happen? So it's pointed out, these are four examples of Vasudeva's wonder. And in relation, oh yeah, this Prabhupada gives it in one purpose, this balance I thought of how to be embracing with wonder. Would in Vasudeva's heart, affection for his son and knowledge of the Supreme Lord's transcendental nature both awakened in the beginning, Vasudeva thought, such a beautiful child has been born, but now cancer will come and kill him. But when he understood that this was not an ordinary child, but the Supreme Personality of Godhead, he became fearless. Regarding his son as the Supreme Lord, wonderful in everything, he began offering prayers appropriate for the Supreme Lord. Completely free from fear of Kamsa's atrocities, he accepted the child simultaneously as an object of affection and as an object of worship by prayers. So I was thinking, this stood out to me as a safe for us, a good way for us to monitor. Because there's a, I think I actually had the quote, but I pulled it out. In Bhagavad Gita, I think in 10.7, Prabhupada makes a point of the purport. One should not underestimate to understand how great Krishna is. Because we have a tendency, and the people in general tendency, to understand how sweet Krishna is. And we hear philosophically and from the Rasatattva, that's the highest thing. But if you want to understand how sweet he is, before you understand how great he is, then it's not going to work. You're going to have problems. So as devotees, we should always keep in this mood, because in one sense, we want to hear about Krishna's childhood passing, because they're naturally more drawn to it. It's just, that's the nature. That's why Krishna brought them here. But we simultaneously have to maintain a reverential mood. And how we offer always reverential prayers and honor. And that's why very much when you make a prayer to the Lord, the first when anybody in the Bhagavatam, when they first make a prayer, what do they normally do?
Glorify.
And specifically, glorify his form. You hear repeatedly about the form of the Lord. So they offer some appreciation for his beauty, and then they glorify his power, and then they usually ask for something. Mm-hmm. It's always consistently, there's always a step-by-step procedure. Recognize, glorify his beauty, recognize his power, and then say, by the way, could you help me, please? Yeah. That's how to pray. Not just go in, dear Lord, I need this. Then it's not Krishna. And that's what you mean. Is it Krishna I'm praying to, or is it like, no disrespect to our anyway, is that how people tend to approach God for like, gimme, 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 right? What can I get from God? But a devotee, we're also happy to turn to Krishna as everything, and Prabhupada encourages us. But to make that distinction between somebody who's trying to have a business exchange or pulling at Krishna as a source, that first we always go to this procedure. Recognize his beauty, glorify him. And actually, if you do that, by the time you get to the point what you want to ask for, you're thinking, actually, maybe it's not so important. Like Dhruva Maharaj. Actually, I don't. And why? Why is that? Because you thought about Krishna first. And every problem is solved by Krishna. Every problem is solved by just thinking about Krishna. So it's nice to, that's the rhythm, the pattern of the Bhagavatam prayers.
I was thinking of a parallel. Prabhupada wanted us to read the 9 cantos before we go to the 10 cantos. To understand who Krishna is.
Yes, very, very much so. Canto 1 to 9, the greatness of Krishna. Canto 10, his sweetness. And it's interesting, he repeatedly tells us to do that. And simultaneously, that's why I said the glory of the Krishna book is a little special. Because Krishna book came in 1969.
But Prabhupada, he didn't know how long he was going to live. So he had to get that
out. He had to get that out first. So, but he put aside the rest of the Bhagavatam. Actually, even the proper Bhagavad Gita wasn't out there. It only came out in full edition later. There was the Macmillan version.
It was written.
It was written. But the actual full full Bhagavad Gita came out really late, and I can't remember the exact detail, but it was 71-72 when the full Honor Bridge edition appeared. Macmillan edition appeared in 68 when Brahmananda. But it's interesting, the full thing didn't come out quite late, and where it was like all complete with Prabhupada, all his comments. Yeah, so he made that extra emphasis to give us the Krishna group. So it's a special book. Yeah, so we have to all approach the, like Krishna like that. The first 9 cantos, Krishna's greatness, and 10 cantos, Krishna's sweetness. So I had to be careful, obviously, we hadn't really what time to go to, but I had two little things to finish off on. And first of all, this is rather seemingly obvious question. But I thought again, manifesting my attachment to games and stuff, but combining it with the churning process. Let us now brainstorm and offer our examples of who is Krishna, my hero, and see where we go. So,
I'm not sure. Half of the absolute dynamics.
Okay, that's the half of the absolute dynamics. Okay, thank you. So I think the other half being. I'm not sure what's even very. We know what he's talking about.
The property as the same to that hippie who want to get initiation, and that hippie said, Krishna is the supreme personality of Godhead.
Yes.
And the Prabhupada asked, who are you? I'm a servant. And Prabhupada said, okay, you can take initiation.
Ah, okay.
So Prabhupada was satisfied with this.
This understanding, yes. He's a supreme personality of God and Krishna's servant. And even that Radha Kramandra gives this brilliant, this supreme personality of Godhead. That term is also a real Prabhupada empowered nugget. How it's so clear and so strong and so philosophically correct. And it's not just philosophically correct, it's also in terms of ras, it's a really empowered term, as my Prabhupada says it, unlimited times. Krishna is supreme. Thank you. Yes, ma'am.
Because the Prabhupada's disciple had a daughter, and she was preaching to everyone. She said, everyone who came the first time, she said, Krishna is the supreme personality of God. She was
starting,
I don't know what was her name.
Oh, the Sarasvati story, yes. Prabhupada said, just look, see how even this little child, she knows more than so many of these great scholars and so-called yogis. This little girl knows so much because she can go out telling her, you know who Krishna is? Krishna is the Supreme Personality of God. Yes, Krishna. Prabhupada also had a special rasa. So. Yes, something else? Maybe I'll go back and forth between ladies and boys. So. Something. Yes, sir.
His dearest friend, every living entity.
And you know the answer to the Sanskrit for that? That's the friend of the fallen.
Suridam.
He's the well wisher of everyone. Yes, very handy. Very well wishing friend. Yes?
He's the son of
Yashoda. Okay. Already. Yes. The origin of everything. And actually, what's. A little Sanskrit for that. What's the But the little problem quote a lot. But then Brahma Sunita, isn't it? The Prabhupada all the Ishvara Parama Krishna Satchinandamigra Anadir Adir. He's the beginning, and he's the Anadir Adir. Anadir Adir Govindam Sarvakarma Khan. He's the swing cause of cause. Prabhupada. It's sound for you.
The paragon of beauty.
The paragon of beauty. Yes, the paragon, of course, for those who haven't got such beautiful English. I mean, but the top end, isn't it?
The highest
beauty.
Full of opulences.
Full of opulences. Should I do that reference now? Should I go for the bottom of the reference? I think I should. just as a little quick side. When preparing for Lord Balaram's appearance class, I listened to one class by His Holiness Sri Ram Maharaj. So I'm now quoting His Holiness Sri Ram Maharaj. This is not Syamananda Das here. So just put myself clear. This is something. When he was asking the devotees, who is more beautiful, Krishna or Balaram? What do we think?
Krishna. He's the most attractive.
Okay, Krishna was attractive. Any response, Yadavana? Do we have any supporters of Balaram here? Any Balaram? No,
there's no difference.
There's no difference. Okay, that's philosophically correct, but the point here, Prabhupada does give a distinction. Anybody? No Balaram supporters at all?
Yeah.
You're all too much Krishna.
It's Janmastami.
Janmastami, you got to tell Krishna. Well, actually, Shivamaraj said, actually, it's Balaram. It's Balaram. And why is Balaram more beautiful? He's white. White. And this white, like yours, it's white is also purity and beauty is white. And looking at it's white. But Krishna is normally known as Sham. Sham means what? Blackish. And Shivamara says, so yes, again, Shivamara said this. Krishna, Balaram is more beautiful, but Krishna is more sexy. That's. If I get in trouble for that, I'm proud to myself. But this blackish, this darkish, this mystery, this it's associated, right? It is. That's the way we associate it. So. And
Krishna.
Here, okay. That's in Hungary, sorry. Here, so okay. So.
That's
what scripture. I'm just quoting Shiva Marjavacha. So yes, so you can next time you see Maharaj, you can say some neophyte bhakta was quoting your Maharaj, you have to be careful. But anyway, you could hear in the room when Maharaj said it was just like So yes, anything else? Who is Krishna? Any other?
He's Gopinath.
He's Gopinath, meaning?
The master of the Gopis.
The master of the Gopis, yes. Any other I could have broke this exercise down more structurally. Any personal meditations, like that's what you ever see, any in relation to us? And actually, we had one already. Any more?
Krishna's everything, actually.
Krishna's everything. But specifically in relation to you, as a devotee.
Give intelligence.
Okay. So you said, if Krishna, like if we do something stupid, it's Krishna's fault. I don't know. Krishna's not giving the intelligence. What can I?
The one who is seen the best.
Everyone. Yes, okay, that's one definitely, and that the Sanskrit
for
Bhavagrahi Janardhan. Krishna picks up the essence, the best of everything. And I was thinking that in relation to, what were we discussing? Balaram. Again, Lord. And actually, of course, I didn't mention, of course, Balaram, we have these three festivals, Balaram Jayanti, Krishna Janmastami, and Balasam. And how, we can see a structure, because we hear definitely Lord Balaram prepares the way for Krishna. And that's there, specifically even in the womb of Devaki, he prepared the womb for Krishna's appearance. And they said, specifically also with his plow, he prepares the way for the Lord's appearance by digging up, digs up the things in our hearts that we have to, look, here, get rid of this. If you want to see Krishna's heart, here, this rubbish, take it out, get rid of it. And then Krishna, but the point about Balaram is that we had Balaram, he does some strange things, and one of them is he's kind of supportive of Duryodhana. And we had a little discussion about Jayanti, like, why? What is this, like, even against Bhima, like the Kurukshetra War? Is this just a weird, inconceivable feature of Lord Balaram? But no, it's not. It's a very, very relevant, very practical thing that we need to have. We need Lord Balaram to be favourable to Duryodhana, because guess who's the Duryodhans, and the word Duryodhana, is Duryodhana dead? No, Duryodhana lives well in the heart of each of us. The degree that we are blaming others, we want power, we're trying to, any desire like this, you can see, and tonight in our demon killing kirtan, we're going to see how the demons represent all the things we need to get rid of. So we don't think Duryodhana was a real person, he was, of course it's there, I don't make it too allegorical, but simultaneously, he represents in each of our hearts the Duryodhana that sits there, the frustration, the unhappiness. And Balaram embraces that. He accepts it. So there we were, full of demonic desires and still full, and yet Balaram brings us into devotional service because he accepts us, even if we are like